Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 14825 in the name of Ross Creer on budget priorities 2025-26. I'd invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible, and I call on Ross Creer to speak to and move the motion around 7 minutes. Mr Creer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name. We're back to being a parliament of minorities, and that means for a budget to pass, or indeed for any parliamentary business to pass, cooperation and compromise will be required. That's not a new challenge for this parliament. Last session and in a number of other previous sessions, compromise has been required. Minority government has been the order of the day. But it is a greater challenge today because Scotland is in a financial crisis. Our public finances are simply not sustainable. And I think it is well timed that this debate is coming at the start of this month, and at the end of the month we will have a government debate on fiscal sustainability, the one that was requested by the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Now, the Green motion today doesn't pretend that devolution is enough. It does not give us all the powers to achieve our goals for Scotland. Under the powers of devolution, we cannot eradicate child poverty. We cannot completely take the required action against the climate emergency. But at the same time, we cannot afford to sit on our hands. It is of no comfort to those at the sharp end to explain the limits of the Scotland Act or the constraints of the fiscal framework. That doesn't help those who are suffering as a result of cuts to public services or who are suffering the effects of climate breakdown. We have a moral responsibility. Yes.
Murdo Fraser.
I'm very grateful to Mr Greer for taking the intervention. I wonder if he would like to reflect upon the fact that under the fiscal framework and the Barnett formula, we have around 20% more to spend per head of population in Scotland than is the UK average, and yet many outcomes in Scotland are poorer than they are south of the border. Why does he think that is?
Ross Greer.
I'm grateful for the intervention. I think there's a range of explanation for those outcomes. The first and foremost is that as much as we have greater spending per head, we are not here in charge of all the levers that affect the day-to-day lives of people in Scotland. Most obviously, we're not in charge of the vast majority of the social security system. And indeed, if his party had not done such immense damage to that system over the previous 14 years, there would be far fewer people in Scotland living in poverty and with worse public health outcomes. Now, Greens do want to see more public spending, but we will be honest about where we think that can come from, where the money can come from, and how that can be raised. We would unsurprisingly take from the road building motorway expansion budgets and put into housing and climate action. And yes, we would raise more from those who can afford it, from supermarkets, for example, or those who travel by private jet. Now, the current balance of tax, spend and the block grant is not sustainable. We might all have different reasons to believe why that's the case, but I think we do all agree that it's not sustainable. And that is a shared responsibility. It's not just the Scottish Government's or the SNP's. Yes.
Neil Johnston.
I think Ross Greer, forgive me, and he's right about sustainability. I think he's also right to think about the additional levies, but I don't think that the levies he's talking about, such as in supermarkets, is enough to cover the sustainability point. What we need to do is grow wage growth faster than UK average, because that's what's baked into the fiscal framework. I just wondered if you'd sort of agree with that point or reflect upon it.
Ross Greer.
I'm very grateful for that intervention because it takes me on to a point that I'm just about to touch on. But before I get to that, just to round off on this point of shared responsibility, all parties in this parliament have voted for budgets at some point in the last 25 years. All parties have contributed areas of spending that we saw as priorities. So we do need to see it as a shared responsibility to get devolved finances back on a sustainable footing. And I would respect the honesty of those who come here and say that they would simply cut their way to balance. It would be immensely destructive and I would oppose it. But there is an honesty to that, and there's not an honesty to what we've seen over recent years. People coming here to demand huge amounts of additional spending, but no tax rises and no cuts in other areas. And on Daniel Johnson's point, I don't think it's an either-or between growing and strengthening our tax base and increasing taxes to raise revenue right now. And I would point to the approach that's been taken in the United States, this recognition that you need to invest, you need to spend more as a government to invest in and strengthen your economy. Their Inflation Reduction Act has been a far more effective way to recover from the global economic turmoil the last few years than the approach taken by most European governments. Now, the Scottish Greens have already proposed a range of revenue-raising options and saving options. The small business bonus scheme, for example, we do support tax support for small businesses, but this is £250 million every year spent on a scheme that the government's own evaluation could find no evidence of positive economic outcomes from. Some of that money, for example, a small amount, albeit, but some of that money goes to the shooting estates owned by the wealthy elite. Some of it goes to businesses that are anything but small. Reform in that area would present a saving option. The grants given to arms companies, again, another small but obvious example. A year into Israel's genocide in Gaza, it is appalling that the Scottish Government's enterprise agencies are still giving public money to these companies. The supermarket levy that I mentioned, at the moment we have a situation where our public services are under significant strain as a result of the harm done by alcohol and tobacco, but the supermarkets who make such a substantial profit from it are not being taxed proportionately to that. And of course, the private jet tax that the Greens have been pushing over recent weeks, albeit on that point we would need to see movement from the UK government around subsidy control. We would also, as I mentioned, cut motorway expansion. Our motion makes the point there around policy coherence. It is not right, it's not effective to spend money both on increasing and on cutting emissions at the same time. We should move the money that is currently being spent on projects that increase emissions into those that would actually cut them. Another example of that would be the fact that the government gives money both to arms dealers and then to the emergency appeals that charities have to launch to deal with the consequences of countries like Yemen being bombed to rubble. Now, the Scottish Government amendment is one that we agree with. The UK Conservative fiscal rules have failed, and we would like to see the new Labour government abandon them, particularly in relation to capital and the ability to invest in the public infrastructure that's required for a strong economy. Just briefly on the Conservative amendment, I'm glad to see Murdo Fraser here. I was hoping that his colleagues were checking he was OK when I saw this yesterday. I was expecting him to come in wearing a sandwich board, shouting, "Doom, doom is nigh." It was such an extreme amendment, I was worried that Fergus Ewing had helped him write it. The Labour amendment, on the other hand, I feel could have been written by the Conservative Party just a few months ago when they were in charge of the UK government. So I do think there's a challenge for Labour here. Where's the vision? Where's the change that is on offer? Now, what's key to the Greens' motion is empowering local government through this budget. The more that they raise, the less that we have an annual haggle here over the general revenue grant. Now, the visitor and workplace parking levies are examples of legislative change that came about as a result of previous budget agreements. I'm sorry, I won't be able to take Katie Clark's intervention, so I'm just closing, presiding officer. Now, the Greens do want to see progress, big and small. We want to see, for example, revaluation of the rates for council tax, but we also want to see the ability to set parking fines devolved to councils themselves. We need to start seeing them as an equal tier of government. There are some direct budget choices and others where, I will be quite honest, we are simply using this as a point of leverage with the government. We're proud of our previous budget agreements that delivered under 22 free bus travel, £1.5 billion of additional income for public services, increasing the additional dwelling supplement, record spending on walking, wheeling and cycling, the Nature Restoration Fund, removing peak rail fares and more. The challenge for the Scottish Government this year won't just be on specific proposals, but on being able to provide trust and good faith to any other party in this Parliament they need to deal with, that what is actually agreed in the budget is what will be delivered. Agreement is possible. The challenge is for the Scottish Government to prove that they are able and willing to deliver it.
If you could move the motion. If you could move the motion, Mr Greer.
I did at the start of my speech, Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Never hurts to do it a second time, just to be sure. As ever with these debates, there is very limited time in hand, so interventions will largely have to be accommodated within the speaking allocations. I now call on Shona Robertson to speak to and move Amendment 14825.3 up to 5 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the Scottish Green Party for bringing this debate to Parliament. And it's absolutely right to say that the fiscal levers currently available to the Scottish Government are inadequate. And we've all felt the impacts of high inflation, austerity and economic turmoil of the previous UK government, and our public services and communities have borne the brunt. We've done our best to mitigate these impacts, but we are doing so, of course, without the full set of fiscal powers that other countries have. The amendment I'm proposing adds to Scottish Greens' motion, calls on the UK government to scrap the fiscal rules of the previous government. We want to see new fiscal rules that enable greater investment to support public services on the transition to net zero. Last week, I met with the Chief Secretary to the Treasury and I raised the need for investment in public services and infrastructure in the UK budget by the UK government. I pointed out the Treasury's own finding that departmental budgets had not been reset to account for inflation, meaning they are £15 billion lower this year in real terms compared to 2021 spending plans. And if we'd had our share of that, I would not have needed to make the spending reductions I announced last month. I want to work with the UK Government to address these challenges and, of course, put our public finances onto a more sustainable footing. The Chancellor's commitment to multi-year budgets will help, but it's not sufficient, and we need a wider range of fiscal tools to manage our budget. Yes, of course.
Daniel Johnson, briefly.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. She rightly is talking about fiscal sustainability. I just wondered what her reflections were on the Fiscal Commission's observation about the £600 million performance gap and what focus the Scottish Government is giving to addressing that.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, what the Scottish Fiscal Commission also said was that there was considerable uncertainty about the resources that will be coming to the Scottish Government from the UK Government. And it is that uncertainty that adds to the fiscal constraints that we have. Moving to multi-year budgets absolutely helps, and it helps us collectively to have a line of sight, both on resource and capital, of how we can get to a more sustainable position while investing in public services. Ross Grier spoke about devolving further powers to local government to provide greater revenue-raising abilities, and I'm very keen to do so. We've already made significant progress on delivering a fiscal framework with local government, and we've delivered on our commitment to enable councils to apply up to 100% premium on council tax rates for second homes from the 1st of April this year. Parliament has also passed legislation to give councils the power to introduce a visitor levy in their area to support investment in the visitor economy. The programme for government makes clear that we will intensify work on designing a potential cruise ship levy, and will be engaging with local authorities and stakeholders over the coming months to develop more detailed proposals. We're also carefully considering... Yes.
Ross Grier, briefly.
Thank you. Very briefly, Cabinet Secretary, through the Chair. I would appreciate if the Cabinet Secretary could confirm it's still the Scottish Government's intention to deliver a cruise ship levy by the end of this Parliament.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, subject, of course, to all the consultation that we need to have and to take on board stakeholders' views of the cruise ship levy, because it's important we get it right. But we're keen to move forward as quickly as we can. We're also carefully considering the responses to the infrastructure levy discussion paper that published in June. If taken forward, this would provide local authorities with an additional mechanism to secure developer contributions to fund infrastructure in their area. Councils will also be able to decide whether to implement a workplace parking levy depending on local circumstances. We will, of course, continue to evolve the joint work on the fiscal framework, and I'm happy to discuss further proposals to strengthen the powers of local government with members from across the chamber. I've said that the Scottish budget for next year will be very challenging, and the decisions the Chancellor takes on the 30th of October will play a big role in determining our funding. Our budget will be focused on delivering the priorities the First Minister set out in the programme for government. And of course, we are spending £134 million this year mitigating the worst of the UK government's damaging welfare policies. So if the Chancellor changes course on these, then of course we'd have more money for further action on those priorities. I had a very valuable session with the Finance and Public Administration Committee yesterday, looking ahead to the Scottish Budget, and welcome further engagement across the Chamber in the weeks ahead. To conclude, Presiding Officer, this motion calls on the Scottish Government to use every power at its disposal to address the urgent social, economic and environmental challenges that Scotland faces. That's what we are doing, but we can only go so far with our current powers. We need to see real change from the new UK Government, increasing funding for public services, investment in infrastructure to support our economy and deliver our net zero ambitions, and of course to end the dreadful social security policies of the previous government. New fiscal rules that focus on public sector net worth, allowing greater investment in the fabric of this country. These are the changes needed to help us address the challenges that we face. If the UK Government is up for it, then we will work together to achieve it. And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak to and move Amendment 14825.2 up to 4 minutes. Mr. Fraser.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, I don't think I've ever seen a motion as full of as much nonsense as the one we've had from Ross Grier this afternoon. So let me pick and try and unpick exactly where the Greens are in error, although I only have 4 minutes, so that will be a great challenge, Presiding Officer. And we should, of course, remember the Green Party is fundamentally hostile to economic growth and to wealth creation, and everything they say needs to be seen in that context. The motion starts by decrying the fiscal levers available to the Scottish Government. So let's just remind the Green Party that the Scottish Parliament is one of the most powerful sub-state legislatures in the world, in terms of its power to make laws and in terms of its fiscal powers. Indeed, even in federal states like Germany, the Länder there look jealously at the amount of fiscal power that this Parliament has. As anybody who's visited Germany would know, as the Minister sits laughing on the front bench. This Parliament has power over non-savings. Of course I'll take this
clear briefly.
To Mr. Fraser for taking the intervention. I'm interested in his thoughts on the question that I posed. Does he believe that this Parliament is powerful enough to eradicate child poverty in Scotland, or does he acknowledge that that would require the cooperation of both governments?
Murdo Fraser.
This Parliament has the most generous block grant in the history of devolution. The block grant has nearly doubled in real terms since this Parliament was established. And as I pointed out earlier, we have 20% more to spend per head of population than is the equivalent across the UK as a whole. This Parliament has vast resources. The question Ross Grier should be asking is, why is that money not being properly spent? Why is that money being wasted, so much of it, if the outcomes here are poorer than in other parts of the UK, as is the case? And this Parliament has power over non-savings, non-dividend income tax, to change completely bans and rates, power over LBTT, power over aggregates tax, power over non-domestic rates, power over council tax, and even the power to create new taxes. It is therefore nonsensical to say that these powers don't exist. Where we would criticise the Scottish Government is that they have used those powers to make the wrong choices. And a case in point is the National Care Service, referred to in our amendment. Money being wasted on bureaucracy that should be spent instead on frontline services. And what we have seen is years of economic and fiscal mismanagement by the SNP in government, propped up, of course, by the Greens in government for a number of years, leading to a situation where we have seen £2.7 billion of taxpayers' money wasted in the course of this Parliament. I'm sorry, I've only got 4 minutes and I've got a lot more to say. I'm sorry, Michelle Thompson. £2.7 billion of taxpayers' money wasted over the course of this Parliament. The UK, Scotland is forecast to have the fifth lowest GDP growth of any UK region. We lag behind the rest of the UK in terms of growth and have done for the last decade. And where the SNP's failure to grow our economy has cost the Scottish budget to date £624 million, according to a calculation done not by the Scottish Conservatives, but by the Scottish Fiscal Commission. And what underpins this is that we in Scotland are paying more tax than the rest of the UK, decisions which are having a negative impact on our ability to grow the economy. I've referred to in this chamber many times previously about the attitude of Scottish business towards the tax differential, with many now having to offer a wage premium to take account of the higher taxes here in order to attract staff. And we also see the destructive approach from the Greens towards housing, which has damaged investment confidence and driven away hundreds of millions of pounds of investment, which has gone elsewhere. No wonder we have a housing crisis, thanks to the Greens' policies when it comes to that sector. So, Presiding Officer, what the Scottish Government should be doing instead is not introducing new taxes, not widening the tax gap with the rest of the UK, but going in the opposite direction, ignoring the economic and fiscal illiteracy proposed by the Scottish Greens, and instead use their extensive and generous fiscal powers to deliver a budget later this year that will prioritise economic growth and reduce the tax gap with the rest of the United Kingdom. That won't be a budget that the Greens will like, Presiding Officer, but it is a budget the rest of Scotland will be thankful for. I'm pleased to move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Michael Manna to speak to and move amendment 148.25.1. Again, up to 4 minutes, Mr. Manna.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I now move the amendment in my name. Can I start by agreeing with Ross Greer that it's certainly a good thing that we're going to have that long-awaited fiscal sustainability debate. There's real challenges in our public finances in Scotland that we need to get to grips with. And obviously, in 8 weeks' time, the Cabinet Secretary will be on our feet here today announcing the budget for the coming financial year, or more likely, the budget for the following 6 months. But there are significant pressures on those public finances, not least the pressure applied by what is an incompetent government that's been wasteful with taxpayers' money and refused to plan for the future. But I am sorry to say that the measures that the Scottish Greens set out today, some of which I think are certainly worthy of investigation, will not be able to close that gap in this coming budget. Last week, the Parliament passed the Aggregates Tax and Devolved Taxes Administration in Scotland Bill. And the Scottish Government plans to introduce the Scottish Aggregates Tax on 1st of April 2026. That's a decade since the Scotland Act in which it was devolved. So it's taken 10 years to devolve a tax, which to a large extent mirrors a pre-existing one. A range of independent experts say they are sick and tired of the idle talk of wealth taxes. They want government to get on and reform the wealth tax that we already have. Council tax. But the SNP have spent 17 years not reforming council tax. Last year, Professor David Bell pointed out to the Finance Committee it had taken 6 years to implement social security in Scotland. And that's giving people money, not taking money away. Yes.
Ross Greer.
I'm grateful to Mr. Mara, and I couldn't agree more with him on the frustration about the failure to reform council tax. Could he clarify Labour's position on reform of the council tax? Would they at least support revaluation, and would they go further? Do they believe the tax should be replaced outright?
Michael Mara.
The Labour Party has brought forward a range over the last decade of measures to reform council tax. We've not found willing partners in this chamber. We are entirely open to have those conversations with the Greens, with the SNP, with the Conservatives and anybody else about how we make those proposals work. We know that it has to happen and we should get on with it. So, providing also you can understand why I am sceptical, given some of the comments that came from the Cabinet Secretary, as to whether a shopping list of additional levies will be the silver bullet for this budget that we now see. But the Greens are right to point to the unholy mess the SNP have made of Scotland's finances. £5 billion lost to waste, failure to grow our economy, leaving us £8.5 billion poorer, nearly half a billion pounds of Scotland money squandered on a black hole rather than invested in our nation's future. The three consecutive years of emergency budget statements announcing swinging in-year cuts across the board. But it does not have to be this way. You would think after 17 years, they would have got to grips with the process, but if anything, it's getting even worse. Part of the problem is clearly how opaque the budget is. A responsible government would surely comply with its agreement with the Scottish Fiscal Commission to supply the data needed for forecasts. But the SNP have failed to produce such fundamental information to the Scottish Fiscal Commission as a public sector pay policy for two consecutive years. And at committee yesterday, the Cabinet Secretary still refused to say whether she would supply a pay policy for this budget this year, when pay accounts for over half of the total budget. Surely that's something that ought to be budgeted for. It's truly shocking levels of incompetence. And of course, it was only yesterday that the Cabinet Secretary did confirm what assumptions she had made on pay in last year's budget. A £375 million understating of the cost. No wonder we ended up with £1 billion of emergency crisis cuts in year. And no wonder that the likes of the Fraser of Allender Institute, the Institute for Fiscal Studies and Audit Scotland have criticised the Scottish Government for its transparency around budgets. Presiding Officer, this incompetent government has well and truly lost its way, and worse still, they have lost control of the public finances, meaning ordinary Scots will pay the price as they pay more and get less.
Thank you. And I now call Willie Rennie again. Up to 4 minutes, please.
The Liberal Democrats will come forward with, as normal, costed, reasonable proposals that will balance a growing economy with an interest in our constituencies, but also protecting the fabric of society. But that is for another day when we see the budget coming forward from the UK Government and further proposals from elsewhere. But today I want to acknowledge the influence of the Greens. There is no doubt that they have made an impact on the economic performance of this country and of this government. On housing, on the climate, on tax, there's no doubt they've made an impact. My concern is what that impact is. My concern is that their lack of concern about the consequences for their policies. Take, for example, reports about behavioural change, people choosing to work elsewhere because of the ever-rising taxes within this country. There isn't a peep, not a word, not a concern. They ignore when house builders tell us that they are investing in England rather than Scotland. They dismiss those as, what do these people know what they're talking about, as if it's not a concern for this government, not just now. When there is evidence that the majority of a particular tax rise will be lost to behavioural change, there isn't any concern, no questions, no concern at all. And where is the commentary about the £624 million economic tax gap as a result of the sluggish economy? Not a peep, not a word, not a concern, as if it's nothing to do with them. This is important that we understand the consequences of the SNP government, including the hundreds of millions of pounds of ScotWind money that has been used to plug the hole in the finances, the problems that we had with the finances, partly created by the economic policies of this party. And the trouble is that they claim to be progressive. They tell us they care more than everyone else, that it is the progressiveness of their party that's bringing more care to this country. But it's not progressive to lose hundreds of millions of pounds in a tax gap. It's not progressive to lose good people who choose to work elsewhere. It's not progressive to fail to build the houses that we're desperate to build in this country. That's not progressive politics. That's cavalier politics, and that's something that we should dismiss. Now, the Greens... I have only got 4 minutes, and there's a lot to criticise with the Greens. They feel cheated, and I do feel sorry for them, because they were thrown out of government when their allies in government were so willingly agreeing to apply their policies in government. So they feel cheated about that. They feel hurt, and I probably would feel hurt as well in those circumstances. But they now come forward with a whole range, a whole suite of more popular policies for us to embrace in this Parliament. The exploration of more fiscal avenues, of lots of new taxes, of putting up income tax, which is how I interpret one of their inclusions in their motion. Without any acknowledgement, not one single acknowledgement of all the concerns that I raised earlier on. And if Mr Greer wants to include this in his summing up, he can do that. But what's important is that we understand the consequences of their policies, of ramping up taxes and the impact on behavioural change, of the loss of income as a result of putting up those taxes, the £624 million tax gap, the loss of the ScotWind funds. None of that was in the speech today. Not one single element. And that's why we should forever reject the policies of the Green Party.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate. I call first Ariane Burgess to be followed by Kenneth Gibson. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Burgess.
Presiding Officer, as we've been discussing, Scotland stands at a critical crossroads. The challenges we face, social, economic and environmental, are not abstract, but daily realities in our communities. These communities are not just affected by these challenges, they are poised to be the vanguard of our response. Throughout this session, I've witnessed firsthand the untapped potential in our communities to combat the climate and nature emergencies. Communities aren't waiting for permission to lead, they're demanding the opportunity. The question before us isn't whether to involve communities, it's how quickly we can empower their leadership. We've seen this work before. During the pandemic, we unleashed the power of local action through trust and openness. This same spirit must now be ignited as we confront climate change, biodiversity loss, housing shortages, homelessness and poverty. But this vision demands robust, responsive local authorities equipped to facilitate and amplify community initiatives. And as we begin to consider next year's budget, the stakes couldn't be higher. If we reconvene this time next year, facing the same obstacles, we will have betrayed not just our councils, who have spent decades calling for reform, but our entire democratic principle of local governance. The time for reports and rhetoric is over. The time for action is now. The Verity House Agreement fiscal framework is an important vehicle for engagement that the Scottish Government must respect. And I understand the dedication required to forge and maintain productive partnerships. But I also know that all can be torn up on an ill-considered whim. Equally, we must not confuse process with making meaningful progress. So while we have the opportunity, let's make progress. Let's build on this framework. There's much to do, but we must start with three critical reforms in local government funding. Multi-year funding. Westminster's indicated spending review could finally break the cycle of year-to-year uncertainty. And I challenge Labour colleagues to leverage their influence with the UK government to secure this vital change. We must escape this Kafkaesque trap that stifles long-term planning. Powers of general competence. The Greens have been working constructively with the Scottish Government on revenue-raising powers, including the cruise ship levy and the carbon emissions land tax. But we must move beyond semantic debates on powers of general competence. The Scottish Greens advocate for councils to have broad revenue-raising powers subject to appropriate oversight. And Edinburgh's years-long wait to implement a visitor levy exemplifies the current system's failings. We need comprehensive devolution of powers, not piecemeal concessions. And council tax revaluation, which has been discussed already, having been involved in these discussions during our time in government, we know the path forward requires bold leadership, and the Scottish Government must convene all parties to forge a consensus on this crucial reform. These changes aren't mere administrative tweaks, but are fundamental to Scotland's community empowerment and wealth-building vision. To see a truly represented Scotland, the Government must also spearhead cross-party dialogue to advance the 4.6 million uplift being called for by SLARC for councillors' pay. It's frustrating, therefore, to see both the Labour and Tory amendments not only remove all mention of local government finance, but fail to make any proposals for how we can ensure our councils are adequately funded to support our communities. Once again, for the Unionist parties, it's a case of all roads lead to Westminster. There's no scope for empowering our communities to make their own financial decisions. Holyrood must live on the handouts from London, and local councils are even further down the pecking order. The Scottish Greens reject this centralising agenda. Our communities are ready, but they need councils that are resourced and thriving to facilitate local leadership. The question is, are we ready to trust councils with the tools they need?
When
we gather here next year, let's ensure that we can point to tangible progress, not just more promises and processes.
Thank you. Just to remind members, we now have no time in hand, and therefore speakers will need to stick to the speaking allowance. I call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Jamie Halker-Johnson. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government faces the most persistent challenges in balancing its budget since devolution, forcing it to make difficult decisions to ensure sustainable public finances. We can't be certain about future levels of funding until the UK Labour Government announces its first budget on 30th of October. Worryingly, if its first 3 months are anything to go by, it looks like the Chancellor's solution will be more austerity in the tradition of Gordon Brown and subsequent coalition and Tory UK governments. Of course, while Labour's group of supine MSPs must follow the Starmer line, the Tories have completely lost the plot and any sense of fiscal rectitude. At last week's General and First Minister's questions, all he offered was a lazy litany of moans and uncosted funding demands. Douglas Lumsden, 8986. Craig Hoy, Pubs, Brian Whittle, Third Sector, Oliver Mundell, Dyslexia Assessment, Pam Gosal, Police Pay. Tory demands already amount to over £1.5 billion a year since early September, with no attempt whatsoever at costing or prioritisation. It's frankly embarrassing. One hoped their new leader would get a grip, but there are no signs so far, although Murdo, always the bridesmaid, never the bride, Fraser, continues to valiantly tilt.
Mr Gibson, I would warn you against nicknames in the chamber, please.
It seems the Green approach to taxation is how much do you earn and hand it over? However, the Scottish Greens at least suggest ways to address the sustainability of public services. A cruise ship levy at the discretion of local authorities seems sensible and in line with actions taken in Greece and Italy. This could benefit Inverclyde, which is subject to harmful sulfuric oxides emitted by cruise liners, despite very little passenger spend being retained locally. Taxing private jets flying from Scotland is an interesting suggestion. I, for one, was surprised that over 12,000 such flights took off from Scotland last year. Whilst a potential source of revenue, government must also look at the potential impact on people employed in crewing and maintaining such aircraft and the airports where the planes are hangared. In 1999, the McIntosh report proposed to give local authorities a power of general competence, a subject in the motion, and I was pleased Arianne Burgess touched on it. I raised this specific recommendation in the Chamber 25 years ago. I was very young at the time, indicating full SNP support. Labour's Wendy Alexander initially backed it, but a year later changed it to a power of general initiative. This was further diluted to a power of well-being set out in Section 20 of the Local Government in Scotland Act 2003. The Society of Local Authority Lawyers and Administrators in Scotland said, and I quote, as envisaged, the courts interpreted the power of well-being in a restrictive way. The underlying reason is the ultra vires doctrine. As long as the doctrine survives, local authorities can only do what they are specifically allowed to do. Thus, the Society concluded the power of well-being contained in Section 20 of the 2003 Act is effectively now dead. So while some sympathetic delivery may not be easy, a public health supplement surcharge on large retailers selling alcohol and cigarettes is already under discussion between Scottish ministers, sector representatives and public health organisations. This recognises the impact of alcohol and tobacco by directly targeting large retailers who benefit from selling such products. However, if tobacco and alcohol duties were devolved, it would better allow reinvestment in improving public health, and this should be pursued. Presiding Officer, the most effective way to ensure sustainable funding for public services, infrastructure and anti-poverty measures is to grow Scotland's economy and widen the tax base. We must focus investment on innovation, research, digitalisation and skills, enhancing productivity and building on our globally competitive successes in life science, phonetics and quantum, to name but three. The phenomenally successful data-driven innovation initiative secured more than £200 million of private investment, four times the target and 4 years ahead of schedule, with our universities providing specialist programmes and initiatives to help 500 cutting-edge companies raise funds to drive innovation in Scotland. This shows a way forward to a more prosperous and dynamic future, and I apologise for not taking interventions, but time, of course, was against me. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. I now call Jamie Hulker-Johnson to be followed by Paul O'Kane. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Hulker-Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As has rightly been highlighted by my colleagues, Scotland is the highest tax part of the UK, largely, although not exclusively, because of Scottish Green MSPs who have backed and encouraged their nationalist SNP colleagues to hike taxes, and who, as they stalked the ministerial corridors of St Andrew's House, feverishly thought of new ways of putting up additional burdens and barriers on Scotland's businesses and individuals. But of course, it's not just taxes, but the impact of their ill-considered and poorly delivered policies too. The botched attempt at introducing a deposit return scheme and the dismissing of genuine concerns of the very industry it was being forced on will appear in textbooks as an exemplar of how not to legislate. Unfortunately, the damage is done, as well as millions of pounds of taxpayers' money lost. Businesses right across Scotland and across my Highlands and Islands region were forced to prepare for a scheme that never happened. All that time wasted, that money, that potential funding for future investment, lost. The stress, strain and frustration of it. And all because Lorna Slater and other SNP Green ministers just wouldn't listen. It has had a serious impact on a lot of those businesses, but it has also damaged their already low confidence levels in how the Scottish Government delivers policy. And why should they have any confidence? I recently met with a group of hospitality, tourism and other local businesses in Fort William, concerned about the implementation of the visitor levy. Because of the way that it has been drafted and introduced by the Scottish Government, as well as being forced into becoming tax collectors, businesses are now being taxed twice, with VAT being incurred on the levy cost. So businesses are being forced to pay tax on tax, forcing some over the VAT threshold and increasing both the financial and regulatory burden for all. And as ever, it didn't have to be this way. Solutions were suggested by industry, but they were ignored by Scottish ministers. And when I asked the Finance Secretary, Shona Robertson, about this only yesterday in Finance Committee, whether she was happy with what I hope was an unintended consequence of the legislation, I received a fairly indifferent response, certainly not one which would give any comfort to the sector that the Scottish Government has any real interest in addressing their concerns. And I suspect that tourism and hospitality businesses in my region will view the SNP's response with the understandable suspicion that this botched legislation won't be amended and nothing will change. And this is, of course, a sector that remembers that it was this Scottish Government that took the UK Government's funding for hospitality and retail in Scotland, but refused to pass it on to the very businesses that it was intended to support. And one that is reeling already, but yet to feel the full extent of the impact of short-term let's licensing. Presiding officer, the Scottish Conservatives have long argued that the best way to grow Scotland's economy is to support businesses, to remove barriers to doing business, and to build an environment that encourages entrepreneurship. But what Scotland has experienced is a nationalist government and a nationalist coalition that has heaped extra rules and regulations and burdens on our businesses. I focused on tourism and hospitality, but the same is true for our fishing sector, with the threat of HPMAs, with farming, and almost any sector that actually wants to grow. And all of this has been exacerbated by Green politicians that continue to oppose much-needed investment infrastructure, like the dualling of the A9, the A96, and other road improvements. That has been devastating for communities across the Highlands and Islands. The Scottish Green Party's coalition with the SNP was a disaster for Scotland. Now we're seeing another unofficial coalition built on the SNP's desperation to squeeze through their endangered budget, threatening Scotland. If this happens, it will not be Scotland's priorities that are delivered, but the Scottish Greens. And we already know how damaged those have been to Scotland's economy.
Thank you. I now call Paul O'Kane to be followed by Michelle Thompson. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. 25 years ago, Mr. Gibson may have been young, but 17 years ago, I was in fact a student. And I remember campaigning in the 2007 election when the SNP ran on a manifesto that promised to abolish and replace the council tax. The current First Minister, of course, was part of crafting that manifesto and has been part of SNP governments bar 1 year ever since. And yet, 17 years later, not only has the council tax not been reformed, but as was reported yesterday, the Scottish Government's Joint Working Group on Council Tax Reform has not even met in the 6 months that John Swinney has been First Minister. In a similar vein, as we've heard already from my colleague Michael Marra, the Scottish Parliament only just passed the Scottish Aggregates Tax legislation to replace the UK Aggregates Levy last week. And that legislation was to make use of tax-raising powers agreed as part of the Smith Commission and passed in 2016, but it's taken a full decade to pass legislation that in many fundamental ways is the same as the prior UK equivalent. And I reference these issues because I do think it is important to look at the fact that this Parliament has tax-varying powers, but of course it takes time to develop, implement and come to fruition in terms of any changes. And it's clear that whilst we're going to have varying levels of disagreement in this debate today and in the debates that will follow with the Greens and other parties on the range of suggestions that are made in their motion today, ultimately none of those changes are going to be brought about in time for the 2025-2026 budget that we are discussing. So I think I won't, just because I have a lot to get through and I'm now in my second minute, so I apologise for Ross Greer. I think if we want to talk about budget priorities for this coming Scottish budget, the real change to the budget process that we need to see is an end to financial incompetence, which has been the hallmark of this SNP government. We need an end to the need for emergency cut statements because they have failed to set an appropriate budget. And that's cuts, let's remember, that included £116 million from the health budget, almost £19 million reduction in mental health services, along with a £24 million cut to active and sustainable travel, and nearly £16 million in cuts to social justice funding. No, I've got much more to say, so, and I only have a short time. We have to have an end to plugging financial black holes created by the government with £460 million worth of ScotWind money, which was supposed to be earmarked for investment in our future, going to repair their black hole. And we need an end to the waste and lack of transparency that we have seen. And we have to reflect that senior Scottish Government sources have admitted that there is waste and a lack of transparency. They have said, and I quote, "We haven't looked under the bonnet properly in years." So we really do need an end to that sort of governance that we have seen in the recent past. So the next Scottish budget needs to demonstrate a return to competence and an intention to grow the Scottish economy, because we know that had the economy grown at the same rate as the UK economy, there could be billions more to spend. And of course, this motion does nothing to address the fundamental problems that poor economic growth is creating in Scotland's finances. We need to ensure that growth is at the heart of what we do, and I think that's been eloquently outlined by my colleagues and will be in closing speeches as well. I just want to turn to the fact that there are no quick fixes in terms of the economic mess that we face, both here in Scotland after 17 years of an SNP government, but also across the UK after 14 years of conservative mismanagement of the public finances and the crashing of our UK economy. But that is the work that the UK government, the new Labour UK government, has undertaken. It will take a time and it will take focus. But I would say that I fundamentally disagree with Mr Greer's assessment, and Mr Harvey did some of this in the debate yesterday, that there has been no change. The priority, the first priorities of this UK Labour government have been to pass changes to planning laws that will help boost house building and infrastructure development. This week we will see legislation for a new deal for working people, to increase the wages of working people in this country, to ensure that their work is stable, that we end fire and rehab hire, that we end zero-hours contracts. So I think it is not fair to make that characterisation of this government, who are committed to change. It's time the Scottish Government started thinking about it.
Thank you very much indeed. I now call Michelle Thompson, the final speaker in the open debate, up to 4 minutes. Ms Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Now, this motion raises some important issues, but no single motion is likely to cover the full complexity of issues involved, and neither will my short speech. Now, I've previously critiqued the new Labour government adopting the Tories' fiscal rules, but don't take it from me. An important essay was published this week on fiscal rules by the distinguished Professor Chadha, Director of the National Institute of Economic and Social Research. I quote his opening lines. The UK's current set of fiscal rules are not fit for purpose. He goes on to say they've clearly introduced an unintended incentive to trade off government investment for government consumption. Now, I'd argue that at least things... Happily...
Daniel Johnson.
Would she at least acknowledge that the rules the Labour government have brought forward exclude capital investment from that borrowing, and it's just on current expenditure, which is different to the outgoing rules, and that there is speculation that they may change?
Michelle Thompson.
Possibly agree to anything. As I'm going to go on to say, it seems to be a moving feast as we speak, if he had read The Guardian today. I'd argue that at least three things argue against a rigid fiscal rule, and that we need appropriate flexibility and discretion in its use. Firstly, we never have perfect information about the economy. Secondly, we don't know what future shocks await. And thirdly, we don't have perfect tools to enable us to meet targets. Perhaps it is these arguments that myself and others have been making that makes the Guardian report today that the UK Chancellor is believed to be considering using an alternative debt metric and abandoning the one she originally intended to copy directly from the Tories. Nevertheless, these changes will simply then increase UK debt, which is currently nearing a whopping £3 trillion and close to 100% of UK GDP. And an additional consequence of this dithering is that it is now more expensive to borrow. Despite this, I support, if it is true, more investment, given the chronic underinvestment, and particularly in capital, of the UK over decades, which has lagged consistently behind other large advanced economies. So turning now to the motion which calls on the Scottish Government to use every power at its disposal. Fight. However, I want to introduce a cautionary note here. Existing powers here are very limited and critically lack the flexibility and discretion needed for overall management of the economy. As a consequence, the very limited powers we do have must not be burdened with the expectation that they can address all areas in need. Now, I'm concerned, for example, that tax is not treated as some kind of easy short-term fix at the expense of medium and long-term growth. If we want to significantly increase our tax take, the most effective way is to grow the economy. And it's an emphasis on growth that is missing from the motion and an over-reliance on limited tax powers. So I return to the insight provided by Professor Chadha. In considering the wider context of fiscal rules, taxation, debt and policy objectives, he concluded we need to take a decision about how to change the level of taxes to meet expenditures and to what extent debt should be issued to allow tax changes, which are sui generis distortionary, to be smoothed. The instruments ought to be used to meet social objective, but in our current framework, and of course he means the UK current framework, they have become the target themselves, and so we have conflated instrument with objective leading to fundamental failures in the regime. And I watch with great interest to see whether the new UK government continues these fundamental failures. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Thompson. We now move to closing speeches. I call first Daniel Johnson, up to 4 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. As ever, I will seek to find some consensus in a debate where I think people have been trying to find disagreement, but I think there is consensus. First of all, I think if we are going to solve the issues around the sustainability of the Scottish Budget, and I think there is consensus that there is an issue with sustainability of that, that there requires to be partnership between the UK and Scottish Government. And I think that stands to reason. And as much as I think colleagues across the chamber might seek to deny, I think the point that was made in an intervention from Ross Grier to Murdo Fraser about the decisions made by the UK Government on things like social security, whatever your view, if you believe that the partnership working needs to be at the heart of the solutions, you have to accept that social security decisions will have had those impacts. But likewise, I think Murdo Fraser was quite right to highlight the Barnett formula and the fact that we have 20% higher spending in Scotland than the rest of the UK. And I think there is a simple question we should be asking ourselves, and one that I think taxpayers in Scotland, are our public services 20% better as a result? And I think if we're being honest with ourselves, they are not. And I think that's what we must strive towards. But I think the other thing I would observe is, regardless of our constitutional views, and there's been much talk about the unionist parties and what they may be saying, the fundamental nature of our economy is such as that decisions made in one part of these islands will always impact the others, and therefore the solutions are always going to be about the governments working together. But there is a fundamental challenge. There is a £2 billion black hole at the heart of the Scottish government's budgets. That is the sustainability point that I think, to be honest, the motion somewhat skirts around. It also skirts around the fundamental issue of the underperformance of the Scottish economy to the tune of £600 million, as identified very clearly in the Fiscal Commission's most recent reports. So I think it's against this backdrop that I think my colleagues Michael Marr and Paul Kane very correctly pointed out the fact that, there is a time lag, at best, between coming up with some of the ideas that have been set out in the Greens' motion and actually their implementation and them seeing fruit. But I would actually go a little bit further. Very briefly.
Ross Grier, briefly.
Thank you. And I agree very much with Mr Johnson's point around the relative underperformance of the economy. If we'd included every point in this motion, it would have been an essay. But does he accept our position that one of the challenges for the Scottish economy is a lack of strategic direction? We cannot be the best. We cannot be a world leader in everything. We need to decide which sectors are the priorities for public support.
Daniel Johnson.
I actually completely agree with that point. It's well made. Can I just very briefly touch a point, the point that was made by Kenneth Gibson about general competence? I think it's a really important one. And actually, I think we do need to look at the role of both local government and, I would say, regional government, because I think that is that where the building blocks of the economies lie, where we're talking about implementation of skills, infrastructure, housing. And I think that is at the heart of where we see growth, because ultimately this is about growth. And I'd just like to, as I close, highlight Willie Rennie's contribution, because I think this goes to the heart of it. If we are going to address the £600 million gap, we cannot just ignore the behavioural effects. We cannot ignore waste. But I think he hit upon something really important, that it's not progressive to ignore those things. I tell you what is progressive: growing above median wage jobs. If we grow above median wage jobs, that is better for the people that are in that employment, but it's also better for the economy and the public finances. Because if we grow our economy just by 0.1% more than the growth of wages in the UK, we get £25 million. So let's deliver those better jobs using the levers we have around skills, infrastructure and planning, and let's drive up the public finances and drive up wages for ordinary working people. That's how we fix this fiscal sustainability problem.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I now call Alexander Stewart. Again, up to 4 minutes, Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be able to close the debate on behalf of the Conservatives, on which is my first new role as the Shadow Minister for Local Government and Public Finance. And I will be supporting the amendment in the name of Murdo Fraser. It is clear that the Scottish public are not receiving the standard of public services they expect. And it's also clear that the Scottish economy has not performed as well as it could have over recent decades. However, it would be flattering the Scottish Government to say that this can be blamed on the lack of powers. As my colleague Murdo Fraser already has highlighted, Scotland has most and among most of the devolved powers in this government in any part of the world. And any supposed failure of devolution is due to the lack of fiscal levers, because they are there, but it's down to successive choices that devolved governments have introduced. Instead of using their devolved tax powers to make Scotland a more attractive place to live and work, the SNP government have done the opposite, presiding officer. They have actually imposed over £1 billion worth of additional taxes. Of course, in recent years, they have been aided and abetted by the Scottish Greens in doing all of this. Presiding officer, the truth... I'd like to make some more progress. I've only got 4 minutes. The presiding officer, the truth is that the current Scottish Government has failed to effectively use its levers to all already that it has in control. When the Labour UK Government decided to cut pensioners' winter fuel, the Scottish Government could have recognised the importance of these payments for Scottish pensioners. These pensioners face lower temperatures in this part of the United Kingdom. This, however, has dealt with the devolution and the way forward. Instead of, however, the SNP government chose to simply pass on the cuts to Scottish pensioners. Even when presented with the opportunity to use devolution for the better, the Scottish government chose to effectively bypass devolution in its entirety. Happy to take one.
Briefly.
I'm grateful to him for taking the intervention. My question be, given these complaints about the £1 billion, actually £1.5 billion of additional taxes, and his complaint the government didn't spend £160 million on winter fuel payments, what would the Scottish Conservatives cut to compensate for those tax cuts and for the appropriate spending on the winter fuel payment they've just proposed?
Alexander Stewart.
Well, we could start with some of the waste, and the National Care Service would be something that we would certainly not be spending billions of pounds on. Presiding officer, I'd like to make a mention of some of the contributions we've heard this afternoon. Murdo Fraser talked about the Green Party being hostile to economic growth and the powers that they have not being used. We've heard the block grant has been continually has grown. We're 20% higher. And the power and the new taxes that are brought in has ensured that Scotland is the highest tax part of the United Kingdom. Wrong choices have been made in and by the Scottish Government. Scotland's Fiscal Commission also highlighted the errors of this Scottish Government going forward. Willie Rennie talked about behavioural changes, individuals, organisations moving out with Scotland, £624 million economic tax. Grab. He talked about the policies that are there and higher taxes. And my colleague, Jimmy Halko-Johnson, talked about Scotland being, as I say, the highest tax part of the United Kingdom, and visitor levies and the failed deposit return scheme. These all matter and make a massive impact, presiding officer. Any debate about the Scottish budget priorities is an opportunity for a constructive discussion on how Scotland's powers can be used effectively. The solutions are proposed today in the Green motion do nothing to address that. Our amendment calls for the Scottish Government to recognise the strategies that higher taxes and anti-growth does not work. Instead, the Government should be doing all it can to ensure that we have make Scotland the best place to live, to work and to invest. So in conclusion, I support the amendment in the name of Murdo Fraser. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. I now invite Ivan McKeed to wind up. Up to 5 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And thanks to Ross Greer and Scottish Greens for bringing this debate to the Chamber this afternoon, which gives us an early opportunity to explore some of the options that may get further discussion as we move closer to budget debates later this year and into next year. And I'd like to thank members for their varying contributions, and I'll come on to talk about some of those shortly. But first, it's important to recognise, of course, the centrality of the UK Government on the 30th of October to this whole process. It will be crucial in determining the funding that we have in Scotland and how far we can deliver on ambitions of this Government and indeed other parties across the Chamber. And for as long as our funding is tied to decisions taken in Westminster, that of course will be the case. The motion is very clear, and we absolutely agree that fiscal levers that we have are inadequate to deliver the change we want to see in Scotland, but we are determined to work with the UK Government to improve this situation. One early indication, of course, will be our amendment proposing that the UK Government changes its fiscal rules, and I understand that the Chancellor will be communicating to the OBR indeed today on how she wants to move forward with those fiscal rules. We want fiscal rules that focus on public sector net worth, meaning our public assets will be properly valued while retaining a prudent approach, allowing investment that we need to build for the future of our economy. And one thing is sure, if the Chancellor continues with the low investment, low growth approach for predecessors, then Scotland will be held back. The Scottish Budget, as it approaches for 25-26, it's important to... Sure, quickly.
Daniel Johnson, briefly.
On the fundamental dilemma in the debate of do you try to fix fiscal sustainability through additional levies or through economic growth, what does the Minister think in terms of what side of that debate does he come down on?
Minister.
Unashamedly pro-growth, and we work to increase fiscal sustainability through increasing revenue through economic growth, as the member well knows. It was good to hear some constructive suggestions from opposition parties today in terms of what they'd like to see included in the budget, but frankly we didn't hear that from all parties, which is a bit of a shame. I missed opportunity, I must say. Turning to some of the contributions, I think Murdo Fraser and the Conservative contributions deserve a special mention. They put in their amendment, mention of financial illiteracy. This from a party that is asking, on the one hand, for £1.5 billion of additional funding, asking, I think there was even more getting added to the list through the course of contributions from Conservative members this afternoon, while on the other hand, looking for £1.5 billion of tax cuts from the Scottish Government, a £3 billion black hole, that is financial illiteracy on stilts, which to be expected from the party, of course, of Liz Truss. The facts are that the Scottish economy in the last stats is growing at the same rate as the UK government. In fact, if you look back over the longer term, it's grown since 2007 per capita at twice the rate of the UK government, and indeed productivity also grown at twice the rate of the UK government. Higher earnings growth in the latest figures in Scotland, and of course the best performing inward investment statistics outside of London across all of the UK. Positive migration from the rest of the UK into Scotland, despite our higher taxes, asking those who can afford to pay more to do so because of the other benefits that people see of coming to live and work in Scotland. And to answer Daniel Johnson's point in terms of 20% more spend, well, we don't have 20% more spent on public services in Scotland. In fact, if you look at our key public sector workers, be it teachers, doctors, nurses, we have, in fact, 30% more per head of population than the rest of the UK, and they're paid more as well. Daniel Johnson wanted to make a brief intervention.
I think the minister.
It's too late. Okay, moving on.
Move on.
Turning to Labour, the much talk about council tax, but no plans as to what they would put in its place, which is interesting to see their direction of travel on that from the party that has looked at the black hole and taken the decision, despite being aware that this was coming down the track, took the decision to make the poorest pay through their cuts to the winter fuel payment. In conclusion, presiding officer, we are using the powers that we do have to maximum effect. Our decisions on income tax since devolution mean we have an additional £1.5 billion to spend on the things that matter to the people of Scotland. Our action on child poverty is making a difference. 100,000 children will be kept out of poverty this year by this government's policies. We're leading the rest of the UK in renewable energy production, have a more ambitious target to meet net zero by 2045. But we need to go further, and I want this Parliament to have the full range of fiscal powers needed to meet the challenges we face and seize the opportunities of the future. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And I now call on Lauren Slater to close on behalf of the Scottish Greens. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The overwhelming narrative in this debate today has been one of scarcity. There appears to be a collective belief that despite living for more than 150 years in an industrial, market-based growth economy, that we find ourselves out of money. This is obvious codswallop. There has been plenty of money and wealth generated. The question really is, where has it gone? When the CEO of BP, from my quick Googling, has an annual compensation package of £8 million, and BP itself made a profit of $66 billion last year, it's clear we don't live in an economy that is short of money. We don't live in a time of financial scarcity. We do, in fact, live in a time of financial abundance. Massive multinational corporations are allowed to make eye-watering profits while generating carbon emissions, pollution, and environmental damage, while they expect other people, usually the public purse, to pay to clean it up or to pay for the consequences. The oil and gas and aviation industries create climate change, but the government has to repair broken bridges, roads, and homes when there's a catastrophic flood. I would ask all members across the Parliament for some honesty in finance. You can't just demand billions more in spending without putting forward tax increases or spending cuts. I know everyone likes to wave the magic growth wand as if that is going to solve all your problems, certainly.
Daniel Johnson.
Acknowledge, just on that very point, that actually the Green Party's own motion doesn't actually set out a range of measures to fix the financial hole that she's alluding to. So I just wonder if she might reflect on that point.
Lauren Slater.
We do. I will aim to set out some more of our measures, which we think can be used to raise revenue within Scotland. Of course, Scotland's revenue-raising powers are quite limited. And this goes nicely into my next point, which is that I do have some sympathies with calls not to tax workers anymore, because income tax is not my favourite tax. It's a tax on people's work. Rents, inheritances and capital gains are all forms of income, but they are all taxed less heavily than people's work. Due to the limited powers of devolution, income tax, as I said, not my favourite tax, is one of the few powers that the Scottish Government have to use, and it is right to use this to generate funding for our public services. Our baby boxes, free public transport for large numbers of people, free eye tests, Scottish child payment, free prescriptions, free university tuition, and better pay for nurses are all things that make Scotland a better place to live, and in my view, provide good value for money. However, limited powers on taxation does not mean no powers, and the Scottish Government should be aligning every policy and all their spending decisions behind their stated goals of tackling the climate and nature emergencies and child poverty. We're not seeing this. What we are seeing from the Scottish Government is policy incoherence. For example, massive spending on expanding road capacity during a climate crisis when they have the stated goal of reducing car kilometres by 20%. This is seriously counterproductive. The Fiscal Commission have calculated that at least £1.1 billion per year more is needed to account for net zero spending. Let's not make that money bigger, let's not make that worse, by spending what money we do have on projects that increase emissions. Failing to reduce emissions now, or worse, increasing them, store up more costs for decarbonisation in the future, as well as increasing the risk of incurring future costs to deal with the effects of flooding, wildfires and other manifestations of the climate crisis. I have some suggestions for both how we can increase revenues in Scotland to support delivery of local services and at the same time incentivise emissions reductions and moving towards net zero. With the limited powers we have in Scotland, one of the things we can do in this space is implement a private jet tax. The intention to allow Scotland to have an airport departure tax has been in place for a decade, but without the key exceptions for islands in order to make policy at all workable. I urge the Scottish Government to urgently approach the UK Government to resolve this issue. Very wealthy people who own large land holdings in Scotland are managing their land in such a way that it is emitting carbon. Land that should be behaving as a carbon sink is deforested or has damaged peat on it. A carbon land tax collected by local authorities would not only fund their journey to net zero and fund local service delivery, but would motivate these large landowners to manage their land in the way that they must for Scotland to reach net zero by 2045. There are so many opportunities that the Scottish Government has to empower local authorities to raise the money needed. A stadium levy to ensure communities benefit when they host large events. A cruise ship levy to ensure communities benefit when they host cruise ships. And all the ideas presented by my colleague Ross Greer, including making good on their promise to properly reform council tax. In wrapping up, I would ask the Scottish Government, how can spending be allocated effectively if there is no clear focus? If tackling climate change and child poverty are really their top priorities, then we need to see coherence across government and align to deliver these things, not different parts of government pulling in different directions. One part of government subsidising increases in carbon emissions, another part funding reductions into them. One part of government increasing road capacity, another part looking for policies to reduce it. One part of government avoiding a public health levy while the NHS is creaking from a lack of funding. I would challenge the Scottish Government to make good on their promises and bring their policies in line with their own stated goals. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Leeser. And that concludes the debate on budget priorities 2025 to 26. There'll be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow front bench teams to change positions should they so wish. Thank you.